I can see we are 21. And today we are going to work on a new topic on RAID, on what you call redundant array of independent disk. So let me share the notes so that we can be able to have a look at them. So it is important that as we discuss about the issue of RAID, it's more of backup. How are we making sure that our data is safe? And that's what we shall be discussing. Okay. So let's continue. Now, when you look at what we are calling RAID, redundant array of independent disk, or originally what they used to call a redundant array of inexpensive disks. But basically, whether you call it inexpensive or independent, I think it is important we say independent disks, because they are different hard disks that users or systems are using to make sure that their data is safe. Like, for example, you have a flash disk somewhere. Mostly you'll be working with RAID 1. You're creating a copy of what is in another place into another safer place. So we're saying RAID is a way of storing the same information in different places. So what you're doing is creating multiple copies to make sure that your data is safe. And you're saying here, by placing data in multiple disks, you're also improving the aspect of input-output operation. So in a way, you're going to improve performance. Instead of loading one disk with a lot of information, you're making sure that the data either is saved in different disks, and that saves you speed and of storage, and also saves you the risk in case of a disk failure. So we are saying the main idea of RAID is to provide group of drives in a system, so that in case there is an interruption or in case one drives fail, you still have a copy. You still have a copy of the same in a different location. So what are the advantages of a redundant array of independent disk? Why is it important to have your data in another disk somewhere, whether a copy of it or all of it in another location? One of them is reliability. Reliability. That means in case one fails, you have no problem. Again, there is also performance improvement, meaning that if you're saving information in two or more disks at the same time, it will not be like saving 10 GB in one disk. It saves you time. And that's what we're referring to as improvement of performance is improved. Again, it allows multiple access, because you can be accessing information from two or more different disks simultaneously. And thus reduces what you call the seek time. You remember the seek time? Time taken to lock, to position a particular sector on the read-write head. So it saves you time, because you're able to do that immediately or at the same time, or what you're referring to as simultaneously. You can be reading two or more disks, or you could also be writing at the same time without any problem. Now we have what you call disk striping. Yeah, disk striping. Now when you talk about disk striping, we are saying here that you are writing data in two or more disks at the same time. So you find that if for example you're storing data in disk one, and you're storing a portion of the data in another disk, a portion of the data in another disk, that's what you're calling a stripe. So we're saying in computers that uses multiple hard disk system, disk striping is the process of dividing a body of data into blocks, and you're spreading that data, or you're saving that data in multiple disks. So it is important to note that, because you'll find that term over and over again. So we're saying here that disk striping is important because you're reducing the risk of saving data in one disk. So for example, if you have, these two disks, you'll save a copy here and a copy here. If for example, your work is A, B, C, D, E, F, instead of saving all of it in one disk, you're saving it a portion here, another block 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 here. That's what you're calling disk striping. And we have two types of disk striping. We have what you call the single user disk striping. And you're saying here, allow multiple hard disks to simultaneously service requests. Simultaneously service multiple input output requests from a single workstation. So this is a single user accessing multiple disks at the same time, a single user. So for example, you're seated in your computer, but you're saving data in two or more disks simultaneously. That is a single user disk striping. You could also be a number of users saving your work in different disks at the same time. That is what you're referring to as multiple user disk striping. And you're saying here that, for example, if you're 10 people, I don't know whether I have another disk here, you could be 10 of you accessing these four disks. Yeah, so you're saving a portion here, another person is saving a copy here, another person is saving a copy here. So you could be five of you, yes, but you're saving your information in different disks. That's what you're referring to as multiple user disk striping. Now, we have different types of RAIDs, and we shall be discussing them. And one of them is what you call RAID 0. Of course, when you say RAID 0, it means that the redundant array of independent disk is not there. So we are saying you're not doing any redundancy at all. You're just saving your information in one disk. Yeah, and that is why it is called RAID 0. There is no redundancy at all. You're just saving your work in one disk, and that's it. Yeah. Yeah, you can use any device as long as we can be able to does not provide redundancy. So it is purely a RAID as per se, because we are using redundancy. And when you say redundancy, it means that you're having more than one copy. So RAID 0, it's truly not RAID, truly. It isn't truly RAID, because we're saying here that there is no what? There is no redundancy, doesn't provide redundancy. And so we're saying RAID 0 requires a minimum of two drives to implement. But basically, there is no chance. Now, if you look at the characteristic of RAID 0, the strip disk array, you're just breaking the data into blocks and saving in different disks. Input-output performance is greatly improved. Why? Because we are breaking the information into blocks. And when you break your information into blocks, it means that you're saving it in different locations. Like here you have A, you have B, you have C, you have D, you have E, you have F. You're saving information in different disks. And that's maybe one of the reasons why it's a bit faster. I/O performance is greatly improved because you have multiple disks that you're saving. Again, it's faster and most efficient array type fault tolerance, because if, for example, you have your B in disk two, once disk two is faulty, then you cannot be able to access this information, and that's the end. Yeah, so RAID 0 requires a minimum of one drive to do that, because you don't need mirroring, you don't need striping, and that negates this statement here, and I think this one should not be there at all. So we're saying here that you may require only a minimum of one disk, because you're just striping in one disk, or if you have two, there is no redundancy. You're saving information in one drive, it is not in the other drive. Now we have what you call RAID 1, or what you call a duplex. And we don't know what is a duplex. I think you've seen the printers, they call full duplex printers. They're able to print on both sides. The same as mirroring. If you have a mirror, you have an image on the other side and you have yourself on this other end. So mirroring basically will require at least two drives, two of them, minimum of two, or a duplicate of two. For example, if you have two disks, then if you're doing mirroring, you may need four, you may need six, you may need eight, because every disk will have a copy of the same. So if you have to do mirroring, you require a minimum of two disks. If you add an extra one, then you must add two. So we're saying here mirroring is basically what you find in servers most of the time. So that the primary hard disk, or what you call the master, you must have the information saved in another disk that you're calling the slave. That's what you call mirroring. And that means with the RAID 1, there will always be a copy of the master, or what you call the first disk, or the primary disk will always have a copy of the same in the other. And that means if you look at the servers that we're using today, if, for example, the disk one fails, for example, if this disk fails, automatically the second disk picks for both the operating system, the antivirus, and everything else is duplicated in the second drive. So whatever is in drive A is duplicated in drive B. I hope that is clear. So that in case this disk have a problem, and it is the one that is having the operating system, the server will automatically switch to the second disk and run the antivirus and manage users and do everything else that the first disk was doing. And that is why it is a very important read, especially for servers in our generation. So we're saying this type of is also known as a disk mirroring, and it consists at least of a minimum of two drives. There is no striping. You are copying everything. You are creating a duplicate of everything. It's not me. It is not. You're not doing striping. Yeah, you're not doing striping. So we are saying here that there is no. Sorry, I've stopped sharing. Yeah, instead of admit, let me share again. So we are saying here that when you're doing RAID 1, you are creating a copy of the entire drive in another drive. So there is no striping. It is photocopying the first disk and having a copy in another disk. And this is very common, especially with our servers today. You cannot find a server that has only one disk. They must be in a pair. They must be two. They must be four or also, depending on which RAID they're using. So we are saying there is no striping. And we said striping means that you're breaking your information into blocks and saving them in different disks. So we're saying the read performance is improved. Reading means accessing. Accessing information is improved since either disk can be read at the same time. Again, the write performance is the same because you also be able to write data. And as you're writing data, it is duplicated in another disk. And you're saying here that it provides the best fault tolerance. Best fault tolerance. It provides the best in a multi-user system, especially in the servers and the others. So we are saying here that RAID 1 requires a minimum of two drives to implement. If you're going to increase, then you must increase in pairs. Either two, either four, either six, either eight, like that. Because you're doing mirroring. Or you're creating what? A duplex. And duplex means two. Now, if you look at this RAID, you will find that, for example, this is A, there is an A here. B, there is a B here. C, there is a C here. D, there is a D here. E, the same happens. And this explains why, especially the modern servers, they are never powered off. They are never powered off. So that in the idle time when the users are not updating the first disk, then the server is doing mirroring. And this basically normally is completed at night. So there must be no power interruption, and the server must never be powered off to allow this mirroring to take place. So we're saying here that what are the characteristics of this? Better read transactions rate than single disk, because you're having two of them. Reading, and we know what is to read. It's better read transaction rate than what you're calling a single disk. If you're accessing information, it's much faster. There is 100% redundancy because you're creating a copy of the first disk. All the paired disks have the same data, meaning that if you have the operating system on this side, there is operating system on the other side. If you have antivirus in this running in disk one, a copy of that antivirus and its data and files are copied in the other. Again, RAID 1 requires what? At least a pair of drives. Recommendation for use. Basically, you can use in payroll, in finance, and especially in servers, it is the most common because we're dealing either with payroll, we are either dealing with financial systems. Now we have what you call RAID 2. So the most important thing to remember in RAID 1 is the aspect of mirroring. RAID 1, mirroring. Or you're creating a duplex, or you're creating a copy, and you require a minimum of two. If you have to increase, you have to increase in pairs, because of the aspect of mirroring. And I think that is very important. Now, when you go to what you're calling RAID 2, or what you're calling Hamming codes, yeah, or what you call error checking and correcting, ECC. So you find that when you're dealing with RAID 2, this one uses what we call striping. Striping, yeah? It uses striping. And you know what is striping. You have to put your information. When you're doing striping, it means that you're placing in a block of data in the first disk and another in another disk. So if you look at it, let me just go to the diagram here. Before I go to the diagram, we are saying here that this type uses what you call striping across disk, with some disks storing what you call ECC courts, error checking courts. Again, we are saying here that we'll be discussing about RAID 3, and you're saying it has no advantage over RAID 3. We'll get there and you'll see. Now, when you look at this, if you look at this RAID 2, we are saying here that you have each bit of data word is written to a data disk drive. For example, you have what you refer to as 0 to 3 here, 0, 1, 2, 3. Now, these are the disks where you're storing your information. But again, you have what you call the ECC drives, or what you call the error, we are calling them the error checking and correcting disks, or disk that will contain that information. Now, it will mean that every time you have information stored in this disk, you have a copy of error checking bits in another location. Whenever you have information here, you have to have another block for checking error. Now, if you look at the cost implication of what you're calling the ECC, it's very expensive. Because if you have a disk that you're storing information, and you have another one for error checking and correcting, it becomes very, very expensive. So we're saying here that each data word has a Hamming code, ECC, each word. For example, if you have a block of data that is stored here, you must create an error, an ECC code for it in another disk. If you have this here, then you have to create another bit somewhere for checking error, and that becomes very expensive. So we're saying each data word has a Hamming code, ECC word, recorded on the error checking and correcting what? Disk, which becomes a disadvantage. So on read, the ECC code verifies correct data or correct single disk error. So for example, if you have a problem in A1 here, for example, if this is A1, and you have that information maybe stored here, it will mean that every time there is an error here, you can correct that information in another disk. And that becomes a challenge. Because for example, if you have so many disks, or you have so much information to store, then it will mean that you will have to create more ECC disks for you to support this RAID 2. Now, let's see whether there is some, there's no additional information that I've given here. But what you need to note here is that the RAID 2 uses what you call striping. And it has also what you call the ECC, the ECC codes stored in another disk. The main disadvantage of this, although I've not recorded it here, but I've noted here that there is no advantage over RAID 3, is that there is additional disk to support ECC. Of course, it is, there is more, it has better fault tolerance. That one we must note. It has better fault tolerance, because if, for example, A0 is faulty, you have an error checking, error correcting code in another disk. That means you can be able to tolerate faults. But the cost of tolerating these faults is very significant, because you have to buy what? An extra disk. And that becomes a major disadvantage. Now, when you look at the next, we are calling RAID 3. We are saying here that instead of us having what we refer to as error correcting disks, we have what you call parity. So we're saying this type, it uses again striping, because if you look at this, we are saying this is A0, A1, A2, A3. We have B0, B1, B2, B3. So that's what we refer to as striping. Yeah. And that saves, especially when you have to write data, the writing of data is very fast when you're doing striping, because you're saving information simultaneously in different disks. But we're saying this type uses what we call striping and dedicate one drive for storing parity information. Now, parity is basically for error checking. The parity information is basically for error checking. Very important. Now, if you compare it with RAID 2, where you're having several disks for error checking and correcting, RAID 2 is more expensive than RAID 3. So we're saying the embedded error checking, ECC information, is used to detect errors, especially in the parity disks. So data recovery is accomplished by calculating what you call an exclusive OR operation, the XOR. And this is an XOR gate. this one. I know you've not done digital electronics, but this is an XOR gate. Yeah, an XOR gate. If you pick this, or even if you Google an XOR gate, you'll find that it is something like this. Yeah. So we are saying here that, of course, it will have an exclusive all of the information recorded in the disk drive. Since an input-output operation addresses all drive at the same time, RAID 3 cannot do what you call an overlap input-output. This is a very important statement, this one. So we are saying here that since the input-output operation addresses all the drives at the same time, RAID 3, you cannot do overlap. It means that when you're writing A1, then you must do A2, you must do A3, and you can do whether it is A4 or whatever. But you cannot do an overlap where you're writing twice here. The same information is being written, A1 and maybe A5 at the same time. You have to go across where you have 0, 1, 2, 3. If it's not enough, then you have to come back again and maybe continue with A4, 5, 6, 7. You cannot do an overlap. So for this reason, RAID 3 is the best for single user system with long record application. It is better because every time you do striping for a single set of data, you have to create a parity for it. You come and do the striping for B, you have to create a parity, an error checking bit for it. You come do the striping for C, you have to create a parity bit. Again, the same happens even for the others. So you're creating stripe, or what you call stripes for each a parity bit for each stripe. So if you have 10 stripes here, then you must have 10 parities for that information. So we're saying the data blocks is subdivided into stripes and written on the data disk. Stripe parity is generated on write, recorded on the parity disk and checked on the read. So every time you do a striping, A1, A0, A1, A2, A3. If that is the end, then you must create what? A parity. And we are saying here that a parity is required for error checking. So we are saying here that this requires a minimum of 3 disks. Why 3? Because you are doing striping. You can do striping in 2 disks, and you must have a parity bit, a parity disk for error checking. So you require a minimum of 3. If you do striping, you require a minimum of 2. If you have to do error checking, then you must add an extra hard disk for the same. So we're saying here, what are the characteristics of RAID 3? Number one, we are saying here that the data is striped across a set of disk with parity information calculated and stored in a different or in a separate disk. You require a minimum of 2 and another one for striping. And that is very, very important. Now, again, very high read and write data transfer. Why so? Because you're doing striping. You have different blocks of data stored in different disk, and that means you can be able to do that very fast. Again, disk fault has low impact on the throughput. If you have a problem, again, if you have a problem with the C1, then the rest of the others will be okay. Again, we are saying here RAID 3 requires a minimum of 3. Why 3? Because for striping, you need 2, and then you need another disk for parity. Now, one thing you need to understand is that the whole of these RAID are controlled by the operating system. For example, when you're doing an installation of the server operating system, and you have to do mirroring, you have to configure that and specify that during installation. Again, when you look at the way we do backups for our data, especially in online system, most of the time you'll find that you're storing information in different geographical location. Like Google, for example, you'll find that they have backups in different countries, especially in the US. Amazon is doing backup in different states of RAID. Either there is mirroring maybe in the far center, and then there is striping in another in different parts of the country. And that reduces the risk of you losing your data. Now that is RAID 3. Now when you look at, as we move from RAID 0, we go to RAID 1, we go to RAID 2, we go to RAID 3, we are trying to improve as we continue. Now, when you look at RAID 4, or what you're referring to as independent data disk with shared parity. Sorry. Now, we say here that RAID 4, independent data disk with a shared parity disk. Now, we say here that as we look at what you're referring to as RAID 4, you will find that it is an improvement of the of RAID 3. It's an improvement of RAID 2. It's an improvement of RAID 1 in terms of the risk of you losing your data. So we are saying here that it uses large stripes. That means when you're saving data in the first disk, and we said here that when you're doing striping, you require a minimum of two disks so that you can break your data and save a portion of it in the first disk, a portion of it in the second disk. If you have to do anything to do with error checking, then you require an additional what? An additional disk. Now, the challenge with what you're referring to as RAID 3 is that it is more of a single user system because there is no overlap. You see this one? It's more of a single user. You cannot do an overlap, meaning that when somebody is writing A0, somebody else cannot be doing what? B0. And that becomes a challenge. So when you look at now RAID 4, we are saying here that this type uses large stripe, which means you can read and record from a single drive. Now, this allows you to take advantage of overlap, what you're calling for the input and output, either you're reading or writing. Since all write operations have to update the parity drive, no overlap is possible. So we're saying here that RAID 4 offers no advantage over RAID 5. We shall go back to RAID 5 in a short while. But we're saying here that when you're having large stripes, it means that if you have information that you want to save in the first disk, then you may take a very short time to save it because it will not spread in many disks. By the time you're going maybe from the first disk to the second disk, you've already saved your work. And that now allows somebody else to take an advantage and do an overlap, either in another disk or in a different location as the process is taking place. So we're saying here that this allows you to take advantage of overlapped I/O for read operations. Since all write operations have to update the parity drive, no input output overlapping is possible. So we're saying here RAID 4 offers no advantage over RAID 5. Now let's look at the diagram for RAID 4 before we look at the differences in terms of the advantages or the disadvantages. Now this is what we call the disk for RAID 4. So we're saying that each entire block is written once, is written onto a data disk. So parity for same rank block is generated on write, recorded on the parity disk, and checked on read. So we're saying this requires a minimum of three disks. Why three? Because we need also what? A parity. Now the difference between RAID 4 and RAID 3 is just the size of blocks, as I'm highlighting here, the size of blocks. RAID 4 uses large blocks. And that means if you're doing striping, you will do a big block of A0 here and A1. And by the time maybe you're getting to the disk 3, you have already finished saving your data. The only thing that will be generated is what? Is a parity. So the difference between RAID 4 and RAID 3, as we had indicated here, where we are talking about RAID 3, and we are saying that RAID 3 doesn't offer a big difference in terms of an advantage. The only difference is that RAID 4 requires what? Large stripes. And that means when you're saving large, big blocks of data, then it takes you a shorter time. And that means you can finish writing within a very short time. You're not breaking your data into several disks. So by the time you're maybe in the second disk, you're already through, and the third disk will be now writing the parity information. So there is no significant difference between RAID 3 and RAID 4. The only difference is the size of block, but the concept is still there, is still the same. So you're only reducing the size of blocks, and that means by the time you're writing the first and the second, almost your data is done. And if you have to go to the third one, then most likely you'll be updating your parity information at the end. Now, we have what we refer to as RAID 5. But before we go to RAID 5, let me take you back to RAID 3 and RAID 4. Now, if you look at RAID 4, we have this parity disk. That is under RAID 3. Now, if you look at RAID 4 again, we have a parity disk. Now, the question comes in, what if this parity disk fails? What would be the problem? That means you will not be able to recover. You don't have a mechanism of recovering from any error once the parity disk is faulty. Now, RAID 5 tries to overcome that challenge. Instead of you having your information in one disk that you're calling the parity disk, you store the parity information in the same disk that you're doing the striping, is the same disk where you're storing your error. Instead of housing all your error information in one disk. Now, let's look at RAID 5. Now, when you look at RAID 5, it is similar to RAID 4 and RAID 3, but the only difference is that these parities are in different disks. So we're saying these types include a rotating parity array, rotating, where you have 0, you have 1, you have 2, you have 3, you have 4. If you have to continue, you have to come back here and again say 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And that continues on and on. So we're saying this type include what you call rotating parity array, thus addressing what you call the write limitation in RAID 4. Now, this means you can be updating simultaneously because the parity information can be saved in whichever disk. So we're saying all read and write operation can be overwrapped, because if somebody is doing E1, E2, E3, E4, you can generate a parity for the same in a different disk. So we're saying here that a RAID 5 stores parity information, but not redundant data. Are you seeing the difference? If this is D0, this is 0, 2, 3, 4, C, B, D. So you're striping information in the same disk. The only thing that you're storing separately is the error checking and controlling information. RAID 5 stores parity information, but not redundant data. So we're saying here, but parity information can be used to reconstruct your data. That is a very important statement. It's like when you're working on your access, the databases, and your database is faulty, you can import your data in another database and forget about your faulty database that contained your data. So you can extract the data and leave your hard disk that is faulty. That's what you're saying here. So RAID 5 requires at least 3, and usually 5 disks, as you can see, 1, 2, 3, 4. Mostly they will be odd numbers. Either you'll find 3, you'll find 5, you'll find 7, like that, because of the aspect of the differences in terms of striping and the creation of the parity. Now we're saying it is best for multiple user system in which some information is not critical or which do few write operation. Why are we saying it can allow multi-user? This can be Alice, this can be Ben, this can be Charity, this can be David, and this can be somebody else. You're saving your information in the first disk and creating a parity in another disk. Right? Somebody else is writing here, creating a parity here. Writing here, creating a parity here. So we can be able, users can be able to operate and use the system at the same time without any problem. So we're saying each entire data block is written on a data disk. Each user, you will be saving your work in one disk, but you have your error control information in another disk. So we're saying parity for blocks in the same rank is generated on write. So we're saying here that the entire data block is written on a data disk. Entire. When you say entire, it means that I'm assuming this is a single user. His or her information will be stored in this entire disk. The only thing that will move to another disk is the parity. So we are saying parity for the block in the same rank is generated on writes recorded in a distributed location and checked on reads. So basically what we mean here is that the user will be saving their data in a single disk like this, but the parity will be saved in a different disk. So that if we need to reconstruct A1, A2, A3, we can use parity in another disk to get this information or to reconstruct this information. That is what we mean. And this means, for example, if one user is updating this, another 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 user is updating this, the only thing that will be stored in a different location is the parity information. And that becomes an advantage for multi-user systems. We have what we call RAID 6, where we are saying here that independent data disk with two independent parity schemes. So we're just trying to increase the ability for fault tolerance. If you look at this, you only have a parity in one disk. But if you want to increase our chances of overcoming errors and becoming fault tolerant, then we can have our parity information stored in another disk. Now, we are saying here that with the RAID 6, if you look at this, we are creating the ability to overcome faults by making sure that our information is in different parity. Our parity is in a number of these. So this type is similar to RAID 5, but include a second parity scheme that is distributed across different drives, and thus providing an extremely high tolerance, especially for errors. For example, if you look at the same concept, but now what happens is that you have parity, more parities in different disks. So the benefit of RAID 6 is to make sure that you overcome faults, or you overcome errors, or you can be able to recover from errors much more easier than when you have RAID 5. So if you look at RAID 6, for example, here we are saying two independent parity computation must be used in order to provide protection against double disk failure. So different algorithms are employed to achieve this purpose. So RAID level 6 requires a minimum of four drives to implement. Four drives. So if you look at this, we are saying here that you have a parity and another parity, another parity and another parity. So you'll find that information in disk 1 or A here, you will find the parities are in two different disks. And that becomes an advantage, especially when you have to overcome errors. So that is the main difference between RAID 5 and RAID 6, where we are saying we have a second parity scheme that is in different drives. Yeah. And that becomes an advantage, especially when you have to overcome errors. Now, if you look at RAID 7, we are saying this time this type includes what we call real-time embedded operating system as a controller. Caching, or what you call disk caching via a high-speed bus, another characteristic of standalone computers. But you can check on this at your own time. But I want us to look at RAID 10, or what we refer to as RAID 1 and 0, or RAID 0 and RAID 1 combined. So let's look at this, and maybe we remind ourselves. Now, when you talk about RAID 0, what did we say? There is no what? There is no redundancy. But when you have RAID 1, it is what we refer to as mirroring. Now we are combining the two. We are combining the disk where there is no mirroring, and then we are now bringing in the concept of mirroring. Now, so we're saying here RAID 1.0 is a very high reliable combination of high performance, where we are combining RAID 0 and RAID 1 and making it what we refer to as RAID 1.0. So we are saying here that when you look at RAID 1, it offers what? Mirroring, yeah? RAID 1 offers mirroring, and then now you can do what you refer to as now the aspect of striping. So let's have a look at it. And we're saying here that so we are combining it RAID 1 and 0, which offers high performance than RAID 1, but at much more cost. There are two subtypes, what we call RAID 0 plus 1. Data is organized as a stripe across multiple disks, and then the stripe disk is mirrored. Now, if you look at this, where we are having A0, A0, B0, B0, C0, C0, D0, D0. That is mirroring, yeah? I don't know if I have another diagram to show the same. Okay, I don't have another one. But we are saying here that in RAID 1 plus 0, the data is mirrored, and the mirrored is striped. But when you have read 0 and 1, the data is organized as stripe across multiple disks. Then after you've done the striping, you mirror. Read 0, 1. If you look at this, we are saying you stripe. And we said striping will require two disks. The diagram is not here, but we're saying when you do the striping, it means that you will store A1, A2, A3, A4, A5, A6, A7, like that. And then now, once you're done with that, then you do mirroring. That is what you refer to as RAID 01. But when you come now to RAID 10, it is the opposite. You do the mirroring, and then you do the striping. You mirror, and then you do the striping. So it is the opposite of the other. And I believe the diagram will not be a problem because, for example, if I'm to show the aspect of striping, I'll do striping. I'll have A1, A0, 1, 2, 3. That is striping. And then I do mirroring of the same. Yeah. So when you're handling what you call RAID 10 or RAID 01, it depends on what you want to achieve. But we are saying RAID level 10 requires a minimum of 4 drives. Why 4? Because striping, you need 2. Mirroring, you need 2. Either way, if you have to do striping and then mirroring, or you do mirroring and then striping, you require a minimum of 2. And that is why we are saying you require a minimum of 4 drives. So we're saying here RAID 0 or RAID 01, you do you stripe and then you mirror. RAID 10, you mirror and then you stripe. That's what we are referring there. Again, you may find a combination of higher levels where you have RAID 5 and RAID 0. Again, if you compare RAID 5 and RAID 0, you can remember this type consists of a series of RAID 5 group. Now, if you look at RAID 5, what are we saying? You see RAID 5? You're having your parity in different disk. And like in RAID 4, where you have a parity disk. Yeah. So you're trying to improve the aspect of fault tolerance by having your parity stored in different location, but again, combining it with the aspect of RAID 0. So we're saying this type will consist of RAID 5 group and striped in RAID 0 fashion to improve RAID 5 performance. Now, when you look at this, we are saying you have your RAID 5 layer, you have a parity here, and a parity here. And then you do the aspect of what? The aspect of striping. Again, you duplicate the information in another location. The same information, you stripe it now in another location. So we're saying here that RAID 0 fashion to improve RAID 5 performance without reducing data protection. Again, we have a number of RAIDs. You can combine RAID 5 and RAID 3 and the like. And I think that is all that we were to discuss about the RAID. You can have more time to go through these and check whether you will see additional information. But the most important thing to understand, especially when you're handling the RAID, is to make sure that you understand the concept. When you're told RAID 1, what is in RAID 1? Is mirroring. If you go to RAID 2, what is in RAID 2, for example, here? Yeah, the challenges of RAID 2. You have error correcting what? Error checking and correcting disks. And that makes it very expensive. Now, when you go to 3, what are you trying to reduce? You're trying to reduce the challenges of RAID 2 by having one disk for parity or for error checking. When you go to RAID 4, what are you trying to do? You're trying to reduce the size of blocks so that you minimize the size of your stripes and making sure that your information is stored much faster in lesser disks. How many disks do you require for this kind of striping? You require a minimum of 3. Striping requires 2, and then you have another disk for parity. And that continues on and on. And I think that is a very important concept. So the only thing that I wish you spend more time is mastering the concept. Get to know what is in RAID 5 and why is it different from RAID 3. Why is RAID 4 different from RAID 3? It's very important to note those challenges and the advantages for the same. And I think that is marks the end of that RAID, unless there is a question. And now, did we handle the question from, I think, 1920, one or... Was it 106? We handled this paper, or we did 2920/105. I think we handled the second one, yeah? Did you do the diploma revision for March series?
Yes.
Because we need to finish the two so that you see the differences between the diploma and the certificate. Did we do the we did 2920?
Yes.
So now we need to do 1920. And I think somebody need to look for the question paper. I don't know whether I have it, but we need to look for the question paper for 1920-106. And then you will see the similarities between the two papers. So I think, God willing, we need to set a date maybe next week and do 1920-106. Yeah. I don't know whether I'll be able to get the question paper so that we can I can post it in the group, and then we can spend time on it. And then you see the differences between the 2920 and the 1920. Any query before we finish our class today?
Yes, I have a question.
Yes, Naomi.
Yeah, how can you illustrate a page table?
How can you
illustrate a page table using a diagram?
A page table?
Yes.
Of course, when you're handling a page, for example, if you remember when you talk about a page, what did we say was a page? We talked about when you're doing that was in let me remember how we were. We talked about paging and segmentation. You remember?
Yes.
Yes. Now we said in paging, of course you will have your program. I don't know whether I can be able to demonstrate it here. For example, let me insert here. For example, if this is my program, I can try to minimize this like that. This could be my page. I can assume that this will be my page, and this will be my frame, for example, yeah. So your question was asking how you can represent a page in a
using a diagram. Okay. Yes.
Using a diagram. Now, we said that a page will represent what? The memory address. Are we together? And a frame will represent what? A process. Are we together?
Yes.
So when you look at paging, we said that the process and the memory, or the memory and the process, are divided into equal size in terms of their size. So if this is five, then this will be five. If this is six, if this is five, this is five. This is five, this is five. This is five, this is five. And of course, here, down here, this will be your memory. This will be your memory, sorry. Your memory, and that this will be your process or your program. So of course this will be addresses. This will be your addresses, and this will be a module. This will be a module. Sorry, this will be your module. Yeah. So this is a module that is 5, 5, 5, 5. So these are memory addresses that are divided into the same. So if you are to draw these, then it will be something like that. So you're representing this. These are addresses. This is a module of a program. These are memory addresses. They are all the same. Yeah. And I think there is a diagram somewhere. I don't know whether it is in our notes. So you can actually represent the diagram like this when you're showing the diagram. So of course this will be your memory, and this is your program. The program will be divided into modules that are the same as the size of your memory addresses. Yeah. And of course it is important to indicate the page will be for the memory, the frame will be for the program. So it is not very, very, very difficult. Again, when you're drawing, you can, for example, if this is your this will be A, memory location A. This can be A, this can be B, this can be C, this can be D, and B. So you can move, for example, this in red, I can actually fill it. Let me just let me just fill it red. For example, that can move there. You see, this can move there. Are we together? You can draw a line showing that this can move here. And then, for example, you have this one moving there. Are we together? You can show with a line. That is basically what you expect. And maybe it will be 4 marks or 5, depending on the examiner. There's another question here asking, I don't know whether I've asked your question. Have I answered your question, Naomi?
Yes.
Okay, now we have another question. You explain audit trail as Houston operating system. Yes.
Like, if you draw those lines.
Yes.
That will not be simple segmentation.
Segmentation is different because this in segmentation, the size of your pages are variant. They're not the same. But for paging, either paging or simple paging, yeah? Either paging or simple paging. This is paging, yeah? Or others will call it simple paging. The two must be the same. The page and the frames must be the same. But in segmentation, they will be very different. You will find that this can be bigger than this. So there can be variant. You can find the first one is bigger. You can find maybe it will be like this. It will be like this. I can merge those. And then you'll find these ones are merged. Yeah, these ones are merged. I can merge them. That will be now, that now will be different. Are we together? So that now this one can move there and another. They'll keep on varying. But for simple paging, the page frame, the pages and the frames are the same. Are we together?
Yes.
Yes. There's a question here, somebody asking about explain audit trail as used in operating system. Now the audit trail is a mechanism that the operating system employs to ensure that it is able to trail or it is able to track who accessed the system, at what time, and what resources that person was using. An audit trail is a mechanism employed by the operating system, yeah, to track who accessed the system, at what time, what resources that person used. Like, for example, today, if somebody wants to know what I was doing in my laptop, he can log into the operating system and do what you call an audit trail. What time did I log in? What was I doing? Which resources did I access? What did I modify? That is what you call an audit trail. Are we together? And that's very, very important, especially especially when you're doing crime trail. You're trying to check who committed which crime at what time. Like, for example, today, if somebody wants to track what you are doing from your end, either in your mobile phone or in your laptop, they can do an audit trail. And they can be able to confirm that you are in class. How many participants were using that? For example, it's from my end. They can be able to track and see how many students were in my class. Which application was running during this time? What did I modify? Yeah, and so on and so on. It's basically a mechanism of being able to confirm and check which resources were being used, who logged into the system, what time, and what resources that person was using, which files did that person modify. That's what we call an audit trail. And it's done automatically by the system.
Now, excuse me,
sir. Yes.
I have three questions.
Yes.
Yeah. The first question says that there's the conditions necessary for a deadlock.
Yes.
Then the next question.
I think that one, maybe we can answer one after the other. When we talk about the conditions necessary for a deadlock, I think we discussed about them. Yeah, the four conditions: hold and wait, circular wait condition, mutual exclusion, and the fourth one was what? I think they are there in our notes. Yeah. Yes. Now the next one.
The next question says that then the disadvantages of the best fit, despite the fact that it's slow.
The disadvantages of
the best fit.
The disadvantages of best fit.
Yes.
How many disadvantages did they ask?
You said four.
Four of them?
Yes.
Now, I think we can discuss them. Now, when you're doing what you call a best fit, it means that the system will have to exhaustively compare the available spaces before it can decide where to position what? It's data. And that means that makes it a bit slow. Number two, there is a lot of CPU overhead. You're going to use the CPU to check the available space. And that means you're going to increase what you call the CPU overhead. That is the second disadvantage. What is the third disadvantage of having the system to check over the entire disk? Of course, the placement will be slow. The placement will be a bit slow. Yeah. What are the other disadvantages of what you refer to as the best fit? Again, it will not be a guarantee that the system will get what? The best fit in terms of the available memory. There will still, and at the end, the system may require to keep on refreshing. Once the processes are reloaded and unloaded from the main memory, the system will keep on refreshing the available holes. And that requires extra time. I don't know whether I've answered all of them. I've given necessarily the four.
Yes, they are answered. The last question.
Yes.
What are the ways of creating, or how can you create a process? State the four steps of creating a process.
A process can be created by the user. A process can be created by another process. A process can be created by the operating system itself. So there are basically three main ways of creating a process. One, by the user, by the operating system, and by another process. I don't know whether there is another way of creating a process, but basically you'll find there are three: the OS, the user, and the process itself. Where we are talking about a child process. So it will depend. But I think those are the three main, unless we check whether there are many others, but those are the three main ways: the operating system, the user, or the process itself.
Okay, thanks. They are all answered.
The other question was, explain two typical components of file access information. Two typical components of file access information. Of course, when you want to access a file, what do you need? When you want to read a file, what do you need? You will need to know the file name and the address location. Of course, the file name is the one that you're using from your end. Yeah. Like if an example is operating system, then you must know the file name. It is operating system. And then, of course, the system will use the address that is represented in that name. Typical components of file access information. Yeah. The name and the address, I think it is important. Distinguish between internal and external security. Internal and external security in file management. Internal security and external security. Am I understanding that? Okay, let me just check. I don't know. Have you tried to Google this? Because I don't want you to answer it in a different context than what maybe would be required. Internal and external file security. Let me see whether I'm able to access it. Difference between reverse and committed pages used in virtual memory. Reverse and committed pages. Let me see. It's not able to open a new file and search. Differentiate between internal and external threats. I don't know, but we are talking internal and external security in file management. I'm just trying to check whether we have a relationship between internal and external security in file management.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
It was in November's paper 2019, so you can just check the answers.
Then November 2019. Let me just see whether I have. I think for the question that I may not be able to handle right away, I can post them in the big group. I don't know. Now, the other question was about reversed page and committed page. Yeah? Now, when you look at what you're calling in a reverse page, these are a set of contiguous pages within the virtual memory. I don't know whether you're writing. Hello, everyone. Now, just write this, because for the reverse and committed pages, maybe we can just write it down somewhere. Now, when you talk about reverse pages, they are set of contiguous or consecutive. They are set of contiguous pages within the virtual memory. that are set aside for a particular process. Are we together? They are set of contiguous pages within the virtual memory, and they are set aside for a particular process. But when you talk about, okay, these pages are basically, they are set aside until that particular process use it. But when you talk about the committed pages, these are pages for which the virtual memory managers have set aside space in the paging file. Committed page. These are pages for which the virtual memory manager has set aside space in its paging. They are already allocated, in short. They are pages that are set aside. There are pages for which the virtual memory manager has set aside space in its paging file. So these are pages that have actually been allocated. Are we together? They've actually been committed. Any other question that was set there? Have you found the question number?
Another question.
Yes.
Explain three types of information that should be found in the memory table.
That was for which paper?
2018 November, question number 8B, Roman 2.
So typical information that should be found in the memory table.
Yes.
Of course, you will have what you call the page number, or what you refer to as the segment number, and then the offset. The page number, segment number, and the offset.
But now they say we explain.
You explain the type of information that should be found in the memory table.
Yeah.
Of course, when you talk about the page number, you're saying that particular block where that information is going to be stored. When you talk about the offset, you're saying if, for example, you're storing a file, you will have to set what we call the base and the limit register. Now, the base and the limit register are the ones setting what? The offset. You remember? The starting point and the ending point on your file allocation table. So that if you're looking for a file called A and it is starting from memory address 001 to 006, which is the offset, you must set what you call the base and the limit register, which is basically giving you the offset. Again, if you're saying that you have to either know the page number or what you call the segment number, or which of the segments are you accessing? Is it segment number 10? It is segment number 10, but what is the offset? It is starting from maybe 0090 to 0095. It will depend. But that information must be provided in the memory table. Are we together? So
yes.
You must be able to explain either the page number, you must be able to explain what? The offset. And that was how many marks? Maybe I can just check the number of marks was...
6 marks.
Yes, yes. So you have to explain the three, whether you're talking about the page number, the segment number, or the offset. Either of the two, you have to explain. Any other question? I think we need to go through the paper that was done in 2019 in November. Is that okay?
Yes.
Now, if you have the paper, I think we can, we don't have so much left. Now, if you have the question paper, you can push it in the common group, and then God willing, we can spend time in the next lesson. Because I've seen you've a number of those questions are like in that very paper of 2019. Are we together?
Yes.
To go through the other paper that was for 1920 106 for the craft. But I would ask you, if you have the question paper for 2019 November, just push it in the group so that people can start revising. And then I can also comment and tell the people that we need to go through that paper. So that whatever answer you have been accumulating and the answers that I'll be commenting, you can compare them. Are we reading from the same script? So OS is continuously evolving. Explain two ways of coping with this trend. OS is continuously evolving. Now, you don't have to keep on updating, buying a new operating system. So how do you cope with the changes in the advancement of operating system? It's just updating your operating system. You can update the operating system either by adding more a new patch that has already been released. If you have a licensed one, you can update the operating system, or you can buy a new operating system if your hardware can be able to accommodate. But you cannot continuously keep on buying. The best way is to update your operating system. Are we together? Let me send you the notes as we speak, so that I don't have pending bills with you after this. Let me forward them to you now. So I have actually shared for the redundant array of independent disks. So I think you have them in your end in a short while. You'll be receiving. So I wish you well. We meet again on, is it on Thursday?
Yes.
Friday morning.
On Thursday? And then Friday morning?
Yes.
So Friday we'll do Friday. We'll be handling November 2019 NEC OS exam. That's what we shall be doing. All the best.